one thinks that that kind of thing is important or the kind of thing we should take into account when we make law or when we do politics. Politicians are going to have no sort of incentive to hold anyone, including themselves, accountable to human rights standards. So basically, if we lose the sort of prerequisite of people sort of invoking human rights-based reasons, and again, sort of just prioritizing those things as they do politics, we'll lose the potential, or at least it's a danger that we'll lose the potential for this kind of mechanism to work. All right. So the sort of second kind of question I want to talk about is whether Trump's America First rhetoric really does endanger human rights norms in the way that should make us worry. And I think, you know, we at least have some provisional reason to be worried about this. So one reason that some people think we shouldn't be worried is that, well, it's just a legitimate thing for a country to talk about putting its interests first. And in fact, that's not mutually exclusive with caring about human rights. You know, maybe we should just conceive of human rights as part of our national interests. So America First really means, well, we're going to promote our national interests in a way that also promotes human rights in the world. And that's a sort of legible way to think about the national interests, and one that's gained popularity over the last few decades. But I actually don't think Trump has given us very much reason to think that's what he means when he talks about America First. In fact, I think he's given us a lot of reason to think that's not what he means. He seems, for example, to think that we should sort of promote America's material and geopolitical interests pretty narrowly conceived, with virtually no consideration for how this affects the interests of other people elsewhere. You could see this, for example, when he advocates for mass deportation, when he advocated during the campaign for killing the family members of people in ISIS, when he advocated for torture, all without any sort of qualms about what these things meant for our commitments to human rights or sort of equality and dignity more broadly. He also seems to talk about America First in a way that's sort of part of a broader view of what it means to be a winner or what it means to be strong, both in general and in the geopolitical scene. So whenever he talks about America First, it's in this context of, you know, we have to be strong, we have to be a winner, we have to not be a loser. And these terms for Trump seem to be associated with a kind of ability to employ control and to control other people sort of regardless of how well or fairly that's done, or what effects it has for other people. So for example, when he talks about, you know, Putin as a strong leader and Obama as a weak leader, we can see that when he thinks of strong and weak, he doesn't really think those terms are sort of indexed to fairness or how people treat others. He thinks they're kind of indexed to an ability to maintain control over some other population. And he seems to think that that's what's necessary. At least in my reading of, you know, what he says in public, he seems to think that that's what's necessary to sort of be strong and put your interests first. So I think we have every reason to believe that that's what he means when he says America First. All right, and so there's a sort of final question, I think, with, you know, both of these topics, which is kind of what can we do as citizens, both to, you know, make our public, our sort of public forums more conducive to the kind of speech that will help enhance our democracy, and also what we can do to sort of stop the erosion of kind of discursive frame that values human rights and equality and dignity. So that's sort of all for my prepared comments. I think we're hoping to have an open discussion with people. I mean, part of the goal of this, I think, is to sort of get together and find out what, you know, you all think are the problems related to this issue, and what we all think we can do together to sort of move forward. So, I mean, feel free to sort of ask us questions, ask each other questions. Yes?
Is it possible for you to summarize some of what you were saying before, because it was hard to hear?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, sure. So I was talking about...
Could you repeat the question?
Her question.
Shoot, yeah.
She asked me to just summarize the comments that you guys couldn't hear earlier. So just very quickly, I was talking about the way that online communication has changed since its inception in ways that may not look particularly political. So as we now have an internet that's populated by privately run for-profit corporations, it looks much more commercial, it looks less political, people aren't deliberating in general, they're posting pictures and whatnot, but in this past election cycle, and even before that, in Obama's two campaigns, we saw some explicitly political communication. We're seeing more and more of that. But it doesn't always look like the kind of deliberation that we might hope that it would have looked like. Part of the reason for that is that we're getting different information. So there's this invisible process of sorting that happens behind the scenes, and when you log on, what you see isn't what I see. And that's fine if we're sort of similar in our basic underlying values and beliefs, but where there's huge difference, there can be huge difference in the kind of information that we receive and the access to the kinds of public forums we have, which creates sort of a general radicalization and polarization within the broader political community, so that when people actually do come together to talk around election time, for example, they end up talking past each other. They don't really understand what each other is saying. And that's a significant problem. So one of the reasons or one of the justifications for the First Amendment being read so broadly in the United States compared to other places is that freedom of speech is supposed to help us be good citizens. It's supposed to help us practice good self-governance. And we miss out on that function when we're just talking to other people who are reinforcing our pre-existing beliefs. And so there's room for everybody at all levels to start making changes here. We need government to start making some changes and trying to speak to everyone, not just your particular constituents. We need private corporations to start thinking more carefully about how they structure their spaces so that they can encourage discussion, meaningful discussion. That means probably something like not sorting information access you have based entirely on popularity, but trying to broaden the scope of what's available to you. It also probably means establishing some kind of norms for what's allowed to be said in those spaces, because some speech is very divisive and some speech is less so or more welcoming, and speech that just kicks people out of those spaces doesn't do much for democracy either. And I think we as citizens need to start taking our job, our obligation as citizens seriously, to learn as much as we can about the world and to engage with others in this process of democratic self-governance and discovery. So that's
yeah. Okay. And I have a question, actually. A lot of times when I'm online, I like to wait for the time.
I don't know.
A lot of times when I'm online and I look at the comments or tweets and whatever, I am shocked by the tone and the hatred that I guess Americans are showing for other Americans. And it's speculated that the Russians have influenced our elections. Do you have any idea what is meant by that statement? I mean, do you think that actually that they are making comment? I mean, how are they influencing or did influence the election?
With discourse.
So there's lots of ways that Russia seems to have influenced discourse, and maybe you can talk a little bit about more generally, but so they have lots of disruptive mechanisms at their control. So one is that the Russian government is known to employ armies of like private harassment bots who will go in and just like flood spaces with negative comments, or even just flood spaces with comments, period, so that legitimate criticism gets drowned in the process. That's one popular technique, and it's incredibly effective. I mean, if you're asking about like hacking and that sort of thing, I don't know.
No, but it's just the comments. It seems like people just turn into trolls when they're online.
But it's not just the trolls you have to worry about. It's sometimes very benign communication that just hides hides information that you don't, that they don't want you to see. So if you send enough stuff out there, you're gonna miss the message that it's for.
We have a question over here too.
Thanks both for being here. Can you hear me okay? I want to kind of tie the two threads together, the America First and the blind spots and talking past each other. I'll start with the question and then I'll give the background. But the question is, in terms of activists and those who are involved in advocating for political change, what sorts of blind spots do you see in that particular community? I'll look to your community, but in that space, because what's surprising to me is in a conversation, for example, about America First, the history of which goes back to World War II, that we can talk about the history of America First without mentioning anti-Semitism once, without mentioning Charles Lindbergh, without mentioning the fact that was used to justify America staying out of World War II because Jews were secretly controlling our foreign policy. It feels as if we're again talking past each other, and important elements of that term have just been left out of our objections to it.
Thanks. Yeah, no, I think that's a great question. And I mean, you're right. Obviously, the sort of idea that we should put our national interests first, even in a very exclusionary way, has a long history. And I mean, I think that this is sort of one of the things that, I mean, in some ways, you know, Trump has played on this, right? Like, there's this narrative he has that, oh, well, we once put America first, and sort of at some point we stopped doing that. And maybe one thing to do to sort of counter that narrative is to say, or to embrace the parts of that narrative that are right, is to say, well, in the past when we've invoked this kind of language, we've sort of done all of these other sort of harmful things, things that we now recognize are flawed, and so we should be sort of skeptical of its uses today. And I mean, I think this is, this has in some ways come up with the sort of refugee debate, right? We've seen the sort of pro-refugee advocates saying, look, we've been down this road before of religious exclusion. This was a problem that we faced in the lead up to World War II when people didn't want to let in Jewish refugees, and we sort of don't want to make the same mistakes again. I think that's a valid point. We should sort of be aware of the historical context in which we're speaking, and also in which sort of politicians in general are acting. Do you want to? I don't know if you have anything to add. Yeah.
I thought that was a great response, but I think just in general, whenever you hear something like America First or France First, or you have to look at what the speaker means by America there. Who's included in America? And it sounds inclusive, but in practice, as you point out, isn't. And you have to look at how systematically those exclusions are made. Definitely a point to be skeptical.
Right. I don't know if that's gonna.
Reading yesterday in the Times, that actually in New Yorker, an article about the Russian interference, and what they say is that the Russians themselves say that they now have an army of 1,000 hackers working on international efforts to corrupt and influence governments, primarily for us because we are their arch enemy, but also in Germany and all around the world. And also, they said that when Trump talks about adding $54 billion to the defense budget, he's probably talking about equipment, you know, ships and submarines and jets, I don't know what, but at any rate, if he's talking about anything other than cyber equipment, the Russians say that in the future, and in the near future, that only 25% of their entire defense budget is going to go to equipment, but the rest of it is going to go to cyber attacking.
So I have two questions. So first, you've been talking about how these political bubbles that we're living in have gotten worse, and I'm actually just curious if there's, so back in the day when there were a lot more newspapers, things used to be very political and partisan and oftentimes would spread falsehoods, and I'm wondering if there's just any evidence that these bubbles have actually gotten worse over time with the internet. And then I guess second is, I'm not really sure what you're advocating for there, but I mean, on one hand, you're saying Facebook and Twitter are using these algorithms and we don't understand them, and that's bad. But on the other hand, there's a lot of speech going on Facebook and Twitter, and maybe as private companies, they should regulate it a little more. And I guess I'm just wondering if, they can regulate it, it's not against the First Amendment, they're a private company, they can do whatever they want. But is this perhaps against American values to do so?
Great questions. So it might be against American values. It makes a lot of people sort of squeamish when we talk about private companies regulating our speech. But in American constitutional law, there's actually a long history of allowing private companies to regulate speech. When you go into a mall, for example, a shopping mall, they have some control over what you're allowed to say in there, because you are allowed to leave and they have a security interest and a private property interest. One of the reasons why we've seen these internet giants not regulating is actually built into the structure of the Communications Decency Act of 1998, I think. So there's a section in that that says basically ISPs are like, should be thought of as newsstands, not newspaper editors. So they shouldn't be held accountable for the content of their speech. And when you make any kind of regulation of them, then you move to the form of an editor, and then you can be held liable for all other forms of speech. So there's actually a disincentive built into the law for these companies to engage in any kind of censorship. But that doesn't mean that they shouldn't. And it seems like we're moving as the problems of like a free-for-all on these sites.
You're saying that if they started regulating, they'd be subject to like something like a libel law?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So if you don't regulate at all, you're not held responsible, except under very rare circumstances, for the speech that takes place on your site. If you start regulating even a tiny bit, then a much larger burden is put on you. But it seems like these large companies, in the wake of this election, have started thinking that they do need to take on a more editorial role, because to say that they weren't doing so ahead of time isn't true. They were sorting for you based on what they thought you would like and based on popularity, and that is a kind of editorializing. And it might not be the best way to do it. So I think that we're seeing them now start to experiment with other metrics for judging how we should receive information. That's ultimately a good thing. It's not a good thing for the state necessarily to go in and tell us what we can and cannot say. But if we're going to use a private service, we can accept a little bit more regulation. And ideally, you know, they create spaces where people feel emboldened to step up and tell each other when they're saying something that's harmful or hateful. And that's where I think the bulk of regulation should happen, is through community norms and community enforcement norms. But right now that's not happening as much as long as we're so separate.
I appreciate the optimism of that comment, but I guess, you know, coming from having gone to college in an era when we thought we were fighting some of these battles, I have a sort of a deep pessimism and concern that absolutely I would love to see this more regulated at the moment, but then that would really, really worry me about that regulation falling into the wrong hands. And then we end up in a situation where we earnest people who are studying and listening to fact-based reality might not be able to represent our reality anymore because the corporations would have taken over too much of it. That would be a concern.
Yeah, that's a very real danger, and there's lots of reason to think that we shouldn't trust these corporate giants who have no democratic accountability to behave responsibly. We have to start appealing to more abstract concepts like journalistic ethics, and that's not much comfort for many people. But I still think it's better than straight up violating the First Amendment and having the government do it, and certainly something needs to change now.
Sure, yeah, I mean, this is definitely a thing to be concerned about. I think, I mean, the thing you were saying before about sort of community norms and community enforced norms could be helpful, right? So, I mean, I think we often think like lots of professions have sort of professional ethics, right? And so, you know, maybe one thing that we can do is start to conceive of what these service providers are doing more, you know, as you were saying, along the lines of a newspaper editor rather than a newsstand. And if there's some way that we can sort of develop a discursive framework around holding them to ethical standards, even if not, you know, legal standards or something like that, could maybe encourage them to sort of change their behavior. So yeah, I think we have a question over here and then in the back. Do you want to come up?
I'm concerned about, I recently read that, and I don't really know the background of this, but that the U.S. Did not sign, this may be in Bush, the kids raid, but the U.S. did not sign the U.N. Article 25 of the U.N. Human Rights Declaration, which sort of is a sort of kind of systemic thing that the ethos of our country doesn't abide by human rights. You know, by human rights. We don't give a lot of gravitas to that. And I don't know what has been done about that, or and of course the UN is seen in many different ways as sort of not as much power to it. So I'm concerned about things like that. Also, I'm concerned about, let's see, the use, you know, the use of language as smokescreen. You know, just this morning, this weekend, when Trump said that Obama had wiretapped his campaign. I mean, I thought for sure this is just a cover-up of the fact that they're going after Trump because of the Russian connection, and it's used an awful lot. I mean, you know, language is twisted. A Chicago Tribune reporter said that facts are dead, and they died a couple of years ago when one of the Republican congressmen said that X number of Democrats in the Congress were tied to the Communist Party, which even the Communist Party denied. So it's sort of like anything goes. What's out there is believed, and so it's a question of belief, and you know, fact is, the word fact in fact is unbelievable.
Yeah, there's some really disappointing aspects of human psychology at play here. It's very, very difficult to convince people to, well, first to look at new information that contradicts their beliefs, and then to evaluate new information in light of their beliefs, and then to accept it if it contradicts their beliefs. It's a much more challenging process than if people come to us with blank slates and ready to hear all sides.
Yeah, I mean, sort of on this point, I think one of the sort of presumptions of a lot of traditional arguments for kind of totally unregulated speech in public spaces and in other spaces is that everyone comes to the table with a similar kind of intent, that is to like discover new arguments and new information and to revise their views if they find something persuasive. And I think, I mean, you know, as you were saying earlier, I think the presence of this new sort of phenomenon of the professional trolls, right, and then people who are just flooding public spaces with lots of meaningless or harmful content kind of challenges that presumption. And so I think it, you know, opens up a whole new set of questions that we have to ask about what we should be doing when we design forums. And you know, and I think you're totally right. I mean, the U.S. doesn't have the best human rights record. It doesn't have the best record of ratifying treaties, even if you don't look at the practice. It's sort of, and so I mean, this may be another thing, you know, to consider when, you know, as you said, we should sort of be thinking about our own blind spots. Like, there are things in our current political practice and our history that suggest this line of, you know, America first, let's forget about human rights is going to have resonance with some people. And we have to sort of figure out how to deal with that and how to combat that sort of harmful transformation of our discursive norms. Yes?
Wait, just really
quickly. Oh, yeah.
So, was it Norway? There's a newspaper that now makes you answer a tiny quiz about the article that you read before you can post comments? just a thought.
That's great.
I was just going to mention that that I read in class about, we're talking about free speech and how there is precedent for restricting free speech, restricting free speech when it blocks the free speech of others. So in that sense, forums can be like a way of preventing other people from speaking up. So there, we do have like some, you could say we have like some moral ground to prevent speech that blocks other speech. So from that standpoint, like, how do we go about doing that? You were talking about how the internet is commercial these days. And I would say I ran across this site that aims to fight the advertising, so they go straight to the source. They try to cut off the money so that everyone has a right to speak, but the platform that speech gets is reduced. And I wonder if you see any issues with this sort of commercial way of regulating speech, of like taking money, and what do you guys think about that?
So how do they take the money out exactly?
If they see articles with hate speech or speech like that, and then they see advertising, they'll contact the advertisers and tell them to pull that advertising.
I mean, that seems like fair play. Right? Like, that seems sort of fine to me. They need, you can let people vote with their feet about the permissibility of speech, right?
It might also be interesting sort of proposal because it's a more decentralized way of doing regulation, right? So there has to be a group that points out to the advertiser that they're involved in this kind of speech, and the advertiser has to respond. So it might avoid some of the worries of, you know, this sort of that the power will fall into the wrong hands. But yeah, that's an interesting thing to think about. Marcus?
Thank you both. And I think related to your comment, one of the difficulties that I see in the current moment is that on the one hand, there is a fear that cracking down on maybe illegitimate uses of, you know, this free speech defense frame then opens up future moments of then, I guess, the proper use of free speech then being repressed. But I think it almost has become an effective shield for, you know, the movements like the alt-right to basically claim free speech to wreak havoc. And so in some way, I guess, what do you see as being the effective balance, if there can be one, or are there frames that we can use that would help us to understand when rights that seem on the surface equivalent, that there's some sort of like extra, this is where I struggle, like some sort of extra legitimacy to one version of free speech.
Thanks. Yeah, no, and this is, I think, you know, right at the heart of the problem. And I mean, it's often talked about in terms of tolerating the intolerant, sort of what are we supposed to do with speech that is obviously aimed at excluding certain people or groups from the public sphere, or aimed at sort of diminishing the ways in which they can contribute. I mean, I think it's a hard question. I mean, my own view tends to be that one thing we can do is at least hold the sort of trolls accountable to their professed standards, right? So if the people on the alt-right say that they're there to, you know, expose this view that deserves sort of close scrutiny and criticism, well, then we should scrutinize and criticize them. And I think that has been one strategy some people have taken, and it's helped to expose some of the hypocrisy of some of the alt-right people and, you know, speakers and groups, because it's turned out, I think, that what they've actually wanted is a forum in which they can express their views and then not have them criticized. So I think one thing we can do is just sort of hold them accountable to their own professed commitment to, you know, outing truth via public debate. But I don't know what you think about this.
I mean, I tend to agree. It's a very difficult question. The Supreme Court has had an impossible time answering it. That's why it's hard to navigate legally what's acceptable speech to censor or censure, and what's not, because it depends. It ends up being very case by case and ad hoc, and that isn't the principle. But you're both, the two last comments are both really right to bring up the distinction between a positive liberty of expression and a negative liberty of expression, and what we found is a completely negative liberty understanding of freedom of speech, where it's just freedom against government intrusion, does produce a lot of speech, but it silences a lot of speech too. And that we do need to have some sort of balance between just allowing people to speak and helping people speak, or liberating them to speak.
I think we're really just talking about gossip, having to deal with gossip, and it's a human thing that's been around a long, long time. But one of the wonderful things about the internet is that if you don't know how much Putin's, Trump is wanting to give to the defense budget, you can say, defense budget increase, how much? Hit your Google and you get the answer right away. So when you're talking to people, I find also, on the one hand, that yes, it's good to check your facts and say, gee, you know, it says here, it's really different from what you say. But it also helps to just ask questions and say, well, what do you mean by that? You know, to tell me how that really works. And say it in a soft tone rather than, well, what do you mean by that? You know, so, otherwise you're taking a fight.
Right.
Tone is one of those things that's still a challenge online. In written text, tone is a challenge when we're talking about highly charged, yeah, issues. People are less generous to one another, especially if they don't know them. It's just an anonymous person on a screen. Luckily, it seems like we're learning some ways to accommodate tone. Language online has changed in ways to become a little bit more casual. There's more use of creative text, stickers and emoji and all that, which help create a more pleasant, like, conversational tone. But you need to go into it with the right attitude, that you're there to discuss, you're there to find out why people believe what they believe, and not just yell at them.
Yeah, no, and I think you bring up another good point, which is that, you know, there are lots of good things about the internet, including, like, the fact that it makes lots of information very easily accessible. And, of course, if you sort of engage in the, you know, the public speech with the aim of using that information to inform people rather than to deceive them, I think, you know, you're right that it can provide good resources for that kind of speech. Are there any other questions? Yeah.
Can I just re-ask my same question again? Like, to what extent is something like Breitbart new from a historical perspective?
Yeah. I mean, you're probably better. So the question is to what extent Breitbart and etc. are new from a historical perspective?
So yellow journalism. Yeah, sorry, I didn't answer your first question. Yellow journalism has existed for a long time. A lot of it has been really ugly. Anyone who's read, like, the early political papers in this country, looking at the stuff, like the smack Jefferson talks about Adams, and, it doesn't look that much better. So I try not to put it in too much of a historical perspective, what's happening now. I think it's always happened. One of the main differences, though, is that it wasn't just, that it's no longer professionals or semi-professionals creating this, it's everybody creating this. And the sheer quantity of what would have been called yellow journalism, but now it could just be called yellow posting, I guess. Like, the size of it, the scale makes it a difference in kind. A difference in scale makes for a difference in kind, is sort of my my approach. And back when we had yellow journalism, like, not as many people read those papers. Lots of people did, but now everybody looks online and looks at these sites and is inundated by them.
I also think there's a sort of difference in that when what you're talking about is like a newspaper that has a partisan line, it's very obvious that someone has intentionally constructed it to appear a certain way. And I think sometimes in some of the online forums, there's this sort of illusory appearance that actually what's happening is just everyone coming and giving their view and no one's doing any sort of, you know, structuring from the top, deciding what gets seen or what gets heard, whereas that's very obviously what's happening when a newspaper picks what articles to publish. And so I think that's a difference too, that, you know, there's this kind of veneer of legitimacy that comes from the idea that, well, this is just a place where everyone comes to put their ideas and whatever comes out of it is sort of a product of the free marketplace of ideas. And I think part of what you're saying is that that's actually, you know, deceptive, right? There are all of these ways in which that information is controlled. So I don't know, we only have a couple minutes left, I think, but does anyone have any final points or questions?
Rants.
I know.
Yeah.
I like Mary's comment before about how to talk to people that have different points of view. And I think that's really what's necessary. And we obviously need more forums to do that. I was listening to NPR the other day, and there was a guy talking, you know, sort of a whole toolkit of how to talk to people with different ideas. It's an art now. It's an art form. And not insignificant one. And I think if we don't do that, we're just going to be yelling at each other forever.
We should probably say something about this.
Okay.
Well,
so first, then just very quickly, like, it is an art form. It's the art of rhetoric. Yeah. It has a long and storied past and fell out of favor for a while, but we need to teach people how to perform rhetoric better, which means not lying or manipulating, it means taking your arguments and presenting them in a way that's going to be palatable.
And actually, what it means for, I mean, what the guy said on NPR is, if you really want to know why people voted the way they did, then you're curious and you should just act on that curiosity, not on this inflammatory thing of how could you do that. I mean, I'm very interested to know. I mean, I read Hillbilly Elegy, and it certainly educated me a bit about the Rust Belt.
Well, perfect note to
I just want to end of this tone that this may be a skill that we all have to learn in this generation. You know, we've come to a point where we have to pay attention then, and maybe we need that skill, so it's about time to talk to each other.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Okay, great. So we actually want to, just before we let you go, there's two free speech now events taking place, one on March 14th and one on March 28th. Fake news, internet hate speech, fake news, and army control. And then the one on March 28th is free speech in and out of the classroom.
I'm super far away from everyone.
So if you guys are interested,
here, a couple more.
I don't know if you're supposed to sign up on this.
Thank you.
Yeah.
There are two there. Oh.
If you want to leave your email to get updates from the day of action, you can sign up right here. But thank you so much. It's been a lot of fun.
Yeah. Thank you for coming. This is a great discussion.